currently the de facto standard in extend server installations is Open vSwitch. A lot of Linux distributions either distribute Open vSwitch or actually thinking about moving to Open vSwitch as a standard bridge interface. Other way around. There you go. So, we suddenly have an OpenFlow capable switch in our hypervisor. So we now have OpenFlow to dictate how traffic flows from one hypervisor to another. There was another problem that people needed to solve there. If you have a port and you want to plug the port onto something, it's a task that is done by, for example, your cloud management system, but there's some networking stuff involved. I mean, OpenFlow is very good at making sure a packet gets from port A to port B, or actually telling your data plane to move a packet from port A to port B. But if you have a virtual device and you have an open vSwitch, where is my port A? I mean, I have a physical port on my network, but there's a virtual port, there's a virtual interface somewhere, and it needs to be provisioned. So one of the things I did with Open vSwitch is actually add the OVSDB. And the OVSDB is the database holding the configuration information for the Open vSwitch. So it's not, it's basically the old control plane. It's where you define, okay, these are the switches I have, these are my bridges, these are my ports, these are the settings for my ports, etc. So in the introduction of OVSDB actually meant that we now have a switch that we can control, we can create ports, we can create devices, we can create bridges, and we can make traffic flow across the bridge using the OpenFlow protocol, for example, or any other existing protocol. When they created that that whole system, they got a new epiphany. Basically, Martin Casado said, okay, at this point in time, I have a system and I can get traffic from one virtual machine on one hypervisor to another virtual machine on another hypervisor, but I need to do a lot of OpenFlow work to get it working. I need to send an OpenFlow flow to my Open vSwitch on node A. I need to send one to my switch, my access switch. I need to send one to my core switch. I send another one to my distribution switch. I need to send another one to the next access switch, and I send another one to my other hypervisor. Because OpenFlow is really, it works on a switch basis. It's a global control, but the flows actually need to be calculated and pushed to every single device. It's really down to the level, like a packet coming in on port A, send it to port B. And on the next switch, the packet I receive from port B, send it to port C. So it's a lot of work. And in the modern era of cloud computing, we want more flexibility. And actually, maybe I don't want my cloud orchestration system to constantly have to redefine my entire switching fabric throughout my network. I want to hide it. I don't want a tenant to have to make changes to my entire core network every time he wants another flow in the network. So we need to virtualize the network. So hence he introduced virtual networking. And a lot of people nowadays think of software-defined networking as virtualized networking. Well, it's actually just a part of the whole software-defined networking scope. But virtualized networking, and especially overlay networking, means that we create a layer 3 fabric in the infrastructure, which is capable of forwarding packets at very high speeds, and usually it's just a flat IP network. It can be as simple as a bunch of switches networked together, either potentially using OpenFlow. You can even statically configure them, but you can potentially use OpenFlow to set up a very basic fabric of switching, basically a single layer 2 broadcast domain. And on that broadcast domain, we're going to create tunnels. And tunnels are created in the layer 3 space, so they're IP-based tunnels, and we use any of the existing protocols that we can. Protocols that are currently in existence, GRE, everybody knows about GRE. It's very good to create tunnels. STT is a protocol introduced by Nicira. STT protocol has the big advantage that being a very dirty hack on TCP, it allows you to get some kind of UDP style traffic over a TCP session, which allows the network card to actually offload it. There's some other protocols, NVGRE and actually VXLAN nowadays. And yeah, I think VXLAN is in a very good position to become almost the de facto standard for this type of network, for this type of overlay network. They support about 16 million. Different networks over a single VXLAN coupling. And actually the reason it's going to be a really good choice is that the network vendors who really sell the switch gear and sell the network interface cards are jumping on a bandwagon, and they're going to be making switches that actually offload traffic. I mean, that's currently the big bottleneck in a lot of overlay networking. How do I get, if I have a 10 gig or a 40 gig network interface card, how do I get my traffic from A to B? With a typical CPU at a modern in a modern computer, you can get up to 2.5, maybe 5 gigabits of traffic before your CPU is overloaded. If you can do overloading, offloading to your network interface card, you can actually push traffic up to the 10 gigs you want out of a 10 gig network. And when we're moving to faster networks, we actually need to have smarter devices, smarter network interface cards that actually offload a lot of this processing. And then there's the next step. I think John already touched upon this, for those of you who've seen the keynote, it's network function virtualization. I mean, basically, truth be told, at the moment, we won. Network virtualization, overlay networking, open vSwitch, open flow, it's there, it's usable, you can get it. It's done, fixed. So what's the next step? And the next step that everybody is now thinking about is the network function virtualization, where network function virtualization is like, how do we deal with the layers 4 to 7? I mean, suddenly we have this whole flexible software-controlled world where we can control flows, control traffic, and make sure that the right bits get to the right point. Why not integrate firewalling with the same thing? If I can control which bits go from which port to which port, which IP addresses are allowed to talk on the network, basically I have a firewall. Do I still need to send all that traffic to some device somewhere in the corner that I actually need to process all the access lists, need to process all the little details I put in, and have him tell the network, okay, send it back because it's not good, or actually process it and use it? No. In a distributed world, if you have software controlled, I can do it at the edges. I mean, think about a 40 gig network interface card with firewalling at the edges. What do you think of the speed? Does anybody already have a 40 gig firewall that's capable of pushing traffic at wire speed through? I don't think so. And if they do, it's ridiculously expensive. What if I could do it with an open vSwitch? Wouldn't that be a lot easier? So that's the next step. So, okay, let's see if we can get a bit more technical here. Meet Bob, my new friend. And Bob is the proud owner of two virtual machines, and he wants those two virtual machines to talk to each other. And he wants to use overlay networking. So basically, Bob is like my cloud tenant. I just gave my cloud tenant access to CloudStack, and I told him, okay, you can create an isolated network, and here you go, boot your first machine. Good luck. So the first thing that happens is that we actually use OVSDB to create all the stuff we need. And this is taken care of by either your cloud management system or by a controller. But the important part is there's an OVSDB connection that will actually create the ports, it will create the virtual interfaces, and last but not least, it will actually create a tunnel. Now we have basically defined all our devices. So we know that there's a virtual interface card, there's a tunnel, and there's a way to communicate between the two hypervisors, or basically between the two open vSwitches. And this is how we do it. Everybody got that? Yeah, great. Now, this is the protocol used by OVSDB. It's a remote access protocol. It's JSON RPC. Yeah, I know. Yet another RPC language. I don't think we have enough of them, so we can have more. In this case, it sort of works. It's OVSDB, and yeah, it's called DB for a reason. It's a database. It consists of a set of tables, and you can send transactions to those tables. And in this case, you can see that this, I'm sending a transaction, and I'm modifying the bridge table, saying I want another bridge. I'm inserting rows into the ports table, telling the system I want another port. And actually, it's set up to use transactions in such a way that all the operations are guaranteed atomic. If I push in a transaction that creates a bridge, creates a port, creates a tunnel, if one of them fails, the entire transaction will fail and will be rolled back automatically by the OVSDB system. Meaning that when you are writing applications against OVSDB, you actually don't have to worry about partial implementations of your network. You just push an entire stack in there, it will figure itself out. One of the nice things they did is that they have a UUID system where you need to push in the unique identifier of a certain port that you're creating. And within the transaction structure, placeholder saying, okay, this is the UUID of the port I'm about to create. I'm calling it new port for now. The moment you actually process this transaction, look for the new port that I've created somewhere, get its UUID, and insert it in the bridge table. So it allows you to create a very complex transaction with interdependencies on IDs without actually having to split them out and create a port, get me the ID, create the interface based on that ID, etc. So I can actually use some kind of, yeah, they call it name keys, which is a placeholder name, and those names are only valid. And the clients can register on a monitor. If you want to know what's happening on the system, you can actually subscribe to the updates and say, okay, show me any updates to the bridge table. Show me updates to the capabilities table. Show me updates to the ports table. And every time one of the things that controls an OVSDB modifies, for example, the user creates a bridge on the interface, or the cloud management system, or for example, libvirt actually creates a VIF and plugs it into an OVSDB port, you will be notified of that event, and then suddenly you can, yeah, you know about the port and you can take appropriate action, which is, as we will, I will show a bit later, a really important feature. So this is really the stuff that creates stuff. So now on to the flows. Actually, a flow is not really spectacular. It's telling you, yeah, okay, I have interface here, traffic can come in, send it to the next port, send it through the tunnel, and send it back out. And this is a protocol we used to do it. This is OpenFlow, one of the OpenFlow protocols. And OpenFlow actually, it modifies flow tables. And as the word says, a flow table is really a thing that has a very simple logic. If a packet matches my match description, I'm going to take an action. Is my match, for example, a packet comes in on port 2, the action might be sent it to port 3. But matches can be very complex. I can make matches based on MAC address, a little bit more complex, but I can make matches on layer 3 characteristics as well. I can say, if my packet matches incoming on port 2, has this particular MAC address, has this particular IP address, has this particular source port, has this particular destination, has this particular destination port, then I want you to send it over to port 5. Otherwise, send it to port 6 or something. And there's a really interesting action in here, and that's the action send to controller, forward controller. Which basically means, I don't know, you deal with it. And that's where this baby gets in, the brains of the whole system. I mean, we were talking about centralized control, and yeah, well, somebody has to do this central control. How does he know what he needs to do? I can forward him packets. So what potentially happens is that I get a packet, I don't know how to deal with it, because yeah, I'm just a stupid switch. Hell if I know. I send it on to my controller, and my controller has a set of rules and thinks, hey, well, I know this. This is actually part of tenant B. This is Bob trying to get his packet to the other virtual machine that's running on that hypervisor. And I know that. So what I'm doing, I'm going to send a new OpenFlow rule back to the switch, telling the OpenFlow, well, if you get packets that match these characteristics, make sure they're sent on. And actually, since I have a pretty good knowledge about the entire network, since I'm the controller and I'm controlling all that stuff using OVSDB, and I get my monitor updates and I can talk OpenFlow, I can actually make sure that the whole path is provisioned. Let me provision the path for you, calculating, okay, I send this packet here, this packet there, forward here, forward there. And then I send back to the OpenFlow system and say, okay, now you can process the packet again. Try it again. And suddenly your not so stupid OpenV switch anymore knows how to get those packets from A to B. This picture is actually taken from the Open Daylight project. It shows like the general flow of how a controller would might potentially work. A lot of the existing controllers currently on the market work on the basic principles that you have a northbound API. Northbound meaning this is the user consumable API, and for user consumable, I generally mean this is consumable by a cloud management system or by a network administrator, but well, we hear about cloud stack, so let's say it's a cloud management system. And I want to be able to tell this controller layer, okay, I've got a network, I've got Bob, and Bob has a network. He has a couple of VMs. You deal with the traffic, you deal with the intricacies of setting up open flows and open V switches. Just give me the network and make it work. Magic happens, black box. Internally, there's the logic that knows about how to deal with stuff. I mean, it works the same as any cloud management system. It's an orchestration. You talk to it via an API telling you in very high level what you want done. magic happens, orchestration happens, the system starts thinking, okay, this is actually the stuff I know about, I have controllers, I have hypervisors, maybe I have a couple of switches, and in the end it results in certain actions that need to be sent out to certain devices. So one of those devices could be an OpenV switch with an OVSDB connection, where I need to push OVSDB configuration and I need to push OpenFlow configuration. On the other hand, it could also be an Arista switch running OVSDB. It could be something else, one of the white label switches with some kind of Linux operating system. It could even be Chef. You tell Chef to provision certain ports. It doesn't really matter. That's the southbound stuff. The southbound stuff is dealing with the particular intricacies of a switch or a hypervisor or some device that I have somewhere in my network that the controller thinks is relevant from getting in the whole process of getting Bob's packet from VM A to VM B. So let's talk for a bit about how this stuff is working inside CloudStack. This is a pretty old picture about the architecture of CloudStack. Stuff has changed a lot, but yeah, I never got around to creating a new picture, and I don't think anybody else did, so we're still using this one for a lot of demos. CloudStack has a plugin infrastructure where you can basically plug in extensions. And for networking, the main things that you want to be plugging into is a thing called the Network Guru and the Network Element. They're running the show in terms of networking. So you have the Network Guru, and the Network Guru knows about networks. And for the Network Guru, a network means a broadcast domain. It's the big thing. It could be a VLAN. It could be a logical switch. It could be another virtual construct. But the main part, it's a whole network. And a network has very simple properties, namely that I can plug virtual machines on that particular network. Anybody using the CloudStack API will see that before you can actually plug your first virtual machine, you need to create a network. This is the network that will be created. It will be created by the guru. The second thing is the network element, and the network element is a thing that thinks it wants to be involved whenever a virtual machine is plugged into the network. So the guru already created a network, and then the network element will actually plug it in and do some magic. It could be that the element is a load balancer, so it sees, okay, I've got a new machine and it needs a load balancer, so I need to be able to talk to it via load balancer. It can be that it's part of the software-defined networking stack that you're working with, and it needs to know, okay, if you're plugging in a new virtual machine, I need to know its UUID, so I can tell it to my networking controller that we have my SDN controller, so the moment it sees a new VIF being created, using the monitored updates from OVSDB, it will actually know that this is the VM that belongs to Bob. So far, most of the software-defined networking plugins have used this module. A plugin definition, how to get a plugin into CloudStack is like the administrative overhead. Created a network guru based on an isolation method. So when you create a new physical network in CloudStack with a particular isolation method, it will actually know, okay, this guru is the one you need to do your work. You can do any magic. Within the Zero plugin, for example, it goes on and talks to the controller and creates a logical switch the moment you hit the Zero network guru. The next thing you want is the element. The element is the one dealing with the individual ports. So the moment a port gets created, a port gets added to a particular network, the element will go out and configure the Zero stack or any of the other SDN stacks. Okay, this is a new port. Configure it, do any magic. And in this case, in the case of Zero, the port actually gets a definition like, okay, this is the NIC UUID and the MAC address of the port I'm about to create. So the moment the port comes up in the network and OVSDB sees it, sends the update to the controller has the definition, said, hey, this guy, this administrator, he just told me that I could expect a MAC address looking like this, and I could expect a NIC UUID looking like this. And he also told me it belongs to Bob's network. So let's match it up and make sure all the magic happens. So that's when I get started with sending the OVSDB flows. I get to do all the provisioning on the bridge at that moment, and that's what the element is doing. And again, here we need some kind of southbound interaction. So that's why we have the whole agent system, and the whole agent system is typically geared to send southbound commands. That's the place where you want your API wrappers. You want to have some generics in there. You want your orchestration logic to have a generic method of designing. Okay, this I want to create a logical port, and then you have an API wrapper, or you have an API directly from a vendor as a Java class. You add it as an agent. You can send commands to it, like, okay, execute this command for me, execute that command for me. That's what the API wrapper does, and the API wrapper actually talks directly to your device. In some cases, it talks to the controller, or it talks to Open vSwitch if you want direct control. And it basically knows how to handle the stuff that you've decided that you should do. I've decided I want a port. The Southbound plugin actually knows, okay, if you want a port, I need to send this particular API command to this particular controller at this time to get it done. So what do we have? So the GRE isolation has been in there for ages. And actually, as part of a Google Summer of Code project, we now have support not only for the Xen server, we actually have support for KVM as well. Thank you, Tuna. Great job. We have Nasira MVP, stuff I've been most involved with. I added to CloudStack. And we have Big Switch, VNS, Midacura, Stratosphere, Contrail, and VXLAN. And the fun thing to see about all those different implementations is that there are some generics, which is the way I just explained how stuff works, but there are also a lot of debate about how stuff should be handled. For example, with GRE and VXLAN, a lot of the control, a lot of the decisions about how to do stuff are actually within CloudStack. CloudStack acts like the brain for this particular type of software-defined networking. With Nasira and Midacura and Big Switch and the others, they really supply a controller. So they're vendors that supply a controller which I can talk to. So what we've been trying to do in CloudStack is get a generic layer that allows you to have any kind of software-defined networking and then plug in whatever we need, be it an API wrapper to talk to an external controller or be it some logic inside CloudStack itself that deals with the networking intricacies. So either way is fine. It's more like a personal preference about what you want done. The other way around. So this is currently the support. As you see, it's really depending on the type of hypervisor. Probably comes as no surprise that KVM has the biggest support. It's really a flexible support system. And actually, I constantly need to update this sheet. It changes over time. And new versions come out, things change. Additional features come in. So this is probably outdated by the time I leave this conference. Actually, I hope so. But this is the support at the moment. So if you're willing to go, if you want to go the SDN route, make sure you check out what kind of hypervisors do I have, what kind of options do I have, and if something is not working, well, send in a patch, make it work. And I think that's almost all there is to tell about software-defined networking in 30 minutes. So, any questions? What they did is really nice. They really built a software-defined networking platform specifically for cloud-type offerings. So they provide a complete solution that not only takes care of your layer 2 networking, but it'll actually also take care of DHCP requests all in a single box. It makes them a great solution to use because you basically get your entire advanced networking as we use in CloudStack ready to go from day one. One of the downsides of that particular system is that due to their complete package deal, it's difficult to actually change stuff around. I mean, the other vendors, they can work with DHCP, they can work with firewalls, etc., but they're generally using the CloudStack virtual router for that, and they just provide a layer 2 services or some advanced features. And Midacura really said, okay, we're going to provide a package deal, everything in one go. Good question. So the question is, how resilient is the infrastructure if you pull out devices or a switch dies? What happens? It's actually up to the particular implementation. I mean, Nasira, for example, the one I'm most familiar with, they will know it happens. They will know that one of the transport nodes go down and they will reroute the traffic. They actually have special constructs in there, like the service nodes, and they're clustered. So they know, okay, this path is no longer available. I'm going to try to find a new path and set up the flows for this new path. Basically, what happens is at a certain point in time, you have a flow that says, okay, push it to port 5. Port 5 doesn't exist anymore, doesn't respond. Then the next option is push it to controller and let the controller figure out. So it's really up to the individual implementation. There's no set standard in overflow flow networking that says, okay, try to have multiple flows. Though it's possible, you can certainly create actions that says push it to flow to port 4 and port 5, and hopefully one of them is actually working at a given point in time. It's really up to the implementation. Any other questions? In that case, thanks for your attention and please enjoy the rest of the conference.